What if it was you that learned to find gold and platinum so proficiently that your sluice box turned gold? Day after day, pound after pound after pound, would it change your life? You may have heard the oft-repeated line that the gold prospectors of the 1800s found 90% of the gems and minerals. But if you saw a modern geological map of just how extensive the gold and gem fields are, even in the east, up through Alabama, Georgia, all the way to New York and Maine, if you knew that these fields also extended in the west, in New Mexico, up through Colorado, Wyoming, out through Arizona, the heavy and rich motherlode area of California, up through Oregon, Washington State, Idaho, Montana, with very rich deposits, down through Utah, North and South Dakota. If you knew that even the Great Lakes areas have deposits, well, you might think something entirely different. Now, if I was to tell you that most of the western states, the 19 states that allow mineral claims to be filed, have been claimed, that would be a true statement. And you might not further your pursuits. But if I was to also tell you that 95% of those claims have gone back to the government because the filers of those claims in the 1800s and later were either deceased or had failed to pay their assessment fees, which are usually under $200 per year, that would also be true, leaving 95% of the West wide open. Now, this is one of the mineral claims that has been closed. This is a lode claim, accessible on the Bureau of Land Management's LR2000 computer. The quartz queen. Why would we look for quartz? Well, we wouldn't necessarily look for quartz, and we wouldn't necessarily file a gold claim. We might file a quartz claim, and because gold is located within quartz, quartz veins. This was a common tactic, especially of the 1800s, where they'd file a claim for sand or, you know, anything other than what they were looking for, which was gold. Quartz or an iron claim. What is the third thing that goes with quartz and iron? It is gold. Closed. And you can go through claim after claim, when it was filed, when it was closed, the dates. Opened in 82, the location date, and if you look for claims that were pre-1975, that would be the date when metal detectors were being perfected. That might give you another angle on your quest. Well, why gold? Why gems? Well, gold and gems have been valuable now for over 6,000 years. Wars have been fought over them. There's not much chance that they're going to be nothing in the near future. We don't have to do much to them to have a saleable item. When they're in the ground, they're of zero value. We don't even know they're there. The minute we dig them up, they have a value. If we take and turn them into a ring or facet them, they have another value. And they have value all along the line. What's created here between nothing and here, it's most valuable, wealth creation, nothing more than capitalism. And the people who facet the material or even make the machines to make that possible, the truck driver who drives it to wherever it's going, all of these things accrue simply as a result of finding these materials. The people who built the nation knew this well when they created the 1872 mining law, which allows the individual to go out on the public lands in the 19 western states and search for our valuable deposits and make them saleable materials. Now, how did the public lands come into being? Well, in the beginning, when all of these lands came on the government register, if you could fence it and then farm it or ranch it, you could have it. They would give it to you. Well, nobody knew much what to do with 300 miles of mountain range or certainly thousands of miles of desert. So they simply stood until gold was discovered. And when gold was discovered, of course, a mad rush began west, virtually leaving the gold deposits in the east to be mined at some later day. Now, to use the public lands out west, you don't have to have a mining claim. In fact, as we've learned, most of the mining claims out west have gone back to the government. The lands in the west are about 95% open. You can simply take the old paperwork and refile on those claims, and voila, you have a new claim. And if you're interested in that, you would go to the you begin by usually going to the county courthouse, pulling out a paper on filing a claim, pay the appropriate fee, you have your points of your 20 acres figured out, your markers. This can be a GPS coordinate, and then you're going to convert that into an old system that was based on Taylor Squares, a warfare system, township and ranges, and describe these points. Now, from there, you're going to take that paperwork, send it to the Bureau of Land Management, and they're going to refile that as a claim, and you're going to pay your appropriate fee to them. All of this is not costly at all. It's, but if you want to do that, you're already on YouTube, and you're going to need to go through filing a claim, the Bureau of Land Management, LR2000 computer system. You want to go through videos on that and learn how to use it. Now, valuable materials on the public lands can go far beyond gold. And if you take and look at this particular rock, you can see that there's veins in it. That's because it's actually, at one time it was a tree. This is petrified wood. We can simply add value to it by putting on a face, drilling a couple of holes. Now we have a pin set, and we've gone through this entire scenario with nothing more than a rock. All right, let's all do an exercise here. This is the belt that extends right on up into Maine, and I'm just gonna zoom right in. I'm going to grab it, come down in here. Let's get nice and tight. All right, here's my counties. I want to know what this material is, so I'm just going to click on it. material here is. All right. Here is the report for that latitude, longitude. Now, where this information originally came from was the Bureau of Mines, and this was all folded into the USGS in the 1990s. Now, what you want to know is what this is. Low sulfide gold quartz vein. And where that's important to you is you're going to take and you're going to overlay your street so you know where you are. The GPAA farm claim is in this area in here. And you're going to then overlay your rivers and streams and creeks and where those go through these areas. That's where gold is being redeposited continually. That's why every time we go to certain locations, we find gold, because the stream action is renewing that gold deposit continually. So if a claim, let's say we've got a claim in here that hasn't been active since the 1800s, do you think you could probably find gold with your modern methods and your modern metal detectors? Well, you know, I think you could. All right, now I'm up here in the northeast. Here's Maine, just down from Maine. I'm just going to click on this group right here, get a report. All right, what have we got? We can come down. We've got our latitude, longitude. We can come right on down. Pegmatites. And if we read on through the report, this is igneous rock. And what do we have associated with igneous rock? Well, gemstones. Now I'm in New Mexico, and here's Texas. I'm going to click on this little area here. Igneous rock. Olivine basalt. So I'm already thinking gemstones. All right, now we're in Arizona. Let's take a look at this piece of ground right here. See what that is. Massive sulfide Curico deposit. These were formed in a hydrothermal environment, and it is a deposit that is rich in copper, silver, gold, very, very rich ground. The big mining companies look for this word, Curico deposit. Oregon side of the line here, and I'll just click that. Low sulfide, gold, quartz, vein. All right, let's take a look at Idaho. Low sulfide, gold, quartz, vein. All right, we're in Washington State, and let's just for grins, let's see what this material is. Low sulfide, gold, quartz, vein. You now know the possibilities. You can no longer be snowed by anyone as to how much gold and gem material awaits you to find. Now I'm going to march right through in this first class, and we're going to find out where the gold comes from, where it most commonly is. We start out with a mineral vein. The residual gold is actually what's on the face. Alluvial gold is simply when it falls down. It's the first place that it falls. A stream placer alluvial gold is when it gets into a stream. And a bench placer is where water activity was once, higher up as the stream was cutting down and left a deposit there. Bench placer. Now, Bajada placer is simply in our dry areas where we've got a mineral vein, got an alluvial placer comes down, generally as a water action or wind action, and it leaves a Bajada placer. Anywhere you look for that on the side of the mountain, in dry areas, wherever you've got a decrease in angle. Now, what kind of gold are we looking for? Well, I don't know about you, but I kind of like my gold to be pure. 99.86% pure, pure gold. Purer than a gold coin, which generally clocks in at 89 to 91%. And this is the kind of gold that we can find when we're looking for low sulfide quartz gold deposits. Pure gold. These are gold-only deposits. They're hosted in granite greenstone terrains. What is that? That's a separated plate from when the gold was formed hydrothermally under the sea. A separated plate. A greenstone belt. Those are those rich areas that you've just seen. A greenstone belt can be for a mile, quarter of a mile, or hundreds of miles, as you've just seen. These are mafic rocks, iron rich. They are deformed, risen earth crust from the bottom of the seafloor. They're serpentinite associated. Serpentine, olivine, the green colored rocks. Okay, they're high in magnesium, olivine, and iron content. Chemically, they're equal to basalt or associated with basalt. We tend to think of basalt as formed up above in a dry environment. If we have an ultramafic rock, these are extremely rich and their associations are with nickel and diamond. Where we have our major faults, and you were just looking at them in the colored areas and you saw these rings, all right, these are the strike and slip zones where the plate has risen up through the host material, and now we have an intrusion. And these are the zones, and this is where when we can get a stream or a river cutting through these areas, that's where we're gonna get our very rich deposits of gold coming out. Now, when gold is formed, and I wasn't there billions of years ago, but this makes the most sense to me from what the geologists say. And as a prospector, you should know something about geology. That's one of the differences between a prospector and a miner. The miner goes in and gets the deposit. The prospector can find deposits anywhere in the world, any type in the world. They just need to know what they're looking for, whether it's gemstones or diamonds or copper or whatever it happens to be. The prospector goes out and finds the deposit. Very often in small scale mining, these people are the same people, the miner and the prospector. You know, it's all rolled into one. Now on the seafloor, we have some kind of magmatic event. We have magma coming up and it starts cooking off the salts. So we get a fresh water environment. The salts form sulfur, a sulfur cap, where gold can be created. We need fresh water to form gold. Now, since we have low salinity here, but we're cooking, we get high CO2, gold is formed. And the way to kind of think about this is like a pressure cooker, all right? It's pressure cooking in here. We have our heat right here. And at some point, this breaks off and starts rising through the earth crust. Now, what we need is slow cooling, because when we have slow cooling, that gives time for the same metals to of like kind to find each other and coalesce in a pool. So when they separate, and they separate it out due to their temperatures, we get pure vein formation, or large crystals in the gemstone world. So pure veins of gold, that's what we're looking for. Okay. When this cap breaks off, we have, anybody who's ever rubbed sulfur, you know it's like ball bearings. So this kind of ball bearing transport, as the plates of the earth slip, they take and raise this portion, and that's how we get our granite greenstone terrains pieces on the surface. There's a lot more underneath that we don't see, so we don't know exactly how deep they are to this day. Now, the earth plates on the Pacific side, the Atlantic side, the earth plates are coming together like this, which forms mountain ranges coming up. The optical effect of that is we get mountain ranges and things like the Continental Divide, a north-south delineation. The practical effect is that the gold-bearing veins are also north-south. And where the mountain ranges are, since they're going north and south, we get weather systems which come up against those mountain ranges and form our weather and cut the mountain ranges with east and west flowing streams. And it's only where those streams flow east and west that we actually got our first indications of where gold and gems were. So you can see, since we only know about the gold and gems that are cut from east-west water flow, you could easily guesstimate that 90% of our gold and gemstones are unknown to us. They have yet to be found. The old timers, when they found a stream, they would find gold, 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 no gold, and then they would start looking up on either side, north, south, and they would look for the deposit, and that's how you would find your load gold, or your gold that you would dig for in the mountains. All right, for this first lesson in gold, I wanted to show you where the gold was, how it was formed, and what the possibilities were. And we'll see you in the next class.